Richie, thanks for joining us this evening. It's an absolute pleasure for me to, like I said, I was at some of your fights when I was young, so it's a pleasure for me to do this with you.
Yeah, that's cool. There's no problem. That's fine. That's great.
Do you know what?
Great introduction, by the way.
When I speak to ex-boxers, and I speak to them about their fights, and I always sort of research the fights, and I always think, I wonder how much of the fights they remember, but they tend to remember every fight in minute detail. Do you find yourself, you do that? You know, sometimes it takes you have to think back, but do you remember each fight you was in?
I remember a specific part of each fight. Like, I remember I boxed a guy named Mark Too Sharp Johnson, fantastic fighter. Probably one of the best fighters, in fact, he is probably the best fighter I boxed. And that's not taking nothing out of a brother. But this guy won 3 world titles. This guy's in the WBC Hall of Fame. And that's how good a fighter this guy is. And I beat him over, it was only over 4 rounds, but it was in Belfast. But when I was boxing him, this fly started flying in the middle of the ring. And we both looked at it and I thought, what shall I do? So I just hit him with a shot, you know. But yeah, shock, surprising that. That's what I can remember out of that fight. As well as when the bell went for the first round, I went out and he'd hit me with 3 or 4 jabs before I'd even thought about throwing a shot. That's how fast the guy was, a fighter. You know.
Before we go into your boxing career, Richie, can you tell us about your childhood growing up? I believe you're 1 of 4 brothers. Your brother Nigel was a boxer. Your dad was a boxer, a very, very good boxer as well. What was your childhood like? Was boxing always in your life from a young age?
Well, there was only 3 of us. We had there's Terry, who was the eldest. He had cerebral palsy, so he was in a wheelchair all the time. But I wore him on my shorts when I boxed for the world title against Marco Antonio Pereira. And then there's Nigel. I know that he was a great fighter, but he never got the breaks that he should have he deserved. But getting brought up in Liverpool, we got brought up in Liverpool 8, and in Liverpool 8, when I was there, you know, morals were quite high, you know, so people didn't rob people's houses, or you could leave your front door open all day and your back door open and no one's going to rob. But when you go to different areas, there's different types of people. Some of them don't show any respect to each other. However, Liverpool's a great city. It's my city, and I'll always love it. But yeah, there was some challenging times in our childhood. But we get through them, you know, you take the good with the bad, rough with the smooth. And my dad was a great fighter. He boxed for England quite a few times and, you know, got to the ABA finals a few times. And people like John H. Tracy talk fondly about my dad. And Robbie Robinson, he's living in Australia now. Well, these guys are superstar guys. These are big-name guys, you know, in the Merseyside area.
Terry Wenton, your dad, and Nigel Wenton, your brother, went on to do a brilliant amateur as well. So you did you look up to your dad?
My dad, we obviously looked up to our father. But as I say, once we'd done this since we were 8 years of age, we started, my dad took us down the gym, Wavertree ABC with Tony Darby. And we'd just be in there. We'd be on the school. We were still in the infant schools and junior schools. And we'd be on the bus after school, straight down to the gym, you know, and waiting outside the gym from 4 o'clock till 6 o'clock when it opened. Sat outside, just waiting there. But that's what, you know, that's what we had to do. We learned it from a young age. In fact, we'd even go and up when we stayed with uncles and aunties. We'd push the chairs to settees back and we'd have a pair of gloves each and we'd spar each other. You know, that was our life. That's what we did. That's all we ever knew. There'd been quite a few different boxing gyms and all of them are very, very good. I can't bring none of them down.
Did your dad want you both to box, you and Nigel?
Yeah, he did. My dad, I don't say he forced us to box, but one time he took us to a karate studio and said, yeah, lads, you know, me and Nigel, my brother, he said, go on, let's see if you like that. Well, we didn't like it, because we were used to boxing. I think he was trying to prove a point to himself that he took, so he took us there thinking, well, I haven't forced him into it, but when you think about it, he probably has, because we used to go to the gym every day, 5 days a week, 6 days a week, you know, even school days and Sunday mornings.
I suppose, like, of any lad who's getting into boxing, if the dad had been a good boxer as your dad had, was you always aware of that and knowing you was trying to impress him? Did he ever put any pressure on you to be good? Did you feel any pressure to live up to his standards?
Well, no, but he would give certain tips and we'd learn a lot off him. We'd learn a lot, like, because he would talk to us about it. If you see him a spawn, he'd say, do this, he'd do that. I mean, I remember one specifically thing he said to me. He said, son, what are you doing? You're in the ring. And this kid must have been hitting me first. And then I was going harder, second. And my dad said to me when I got out the ring, he said, is it one of them games whereas you hit me and I'll hit you? You hit me and I'll hit you? No. You always be first. Always be first. Get in there and get out. It's the game is about being hit, you know, hitting people and not getting hit.
When did you realise, Richie, that you was good enough to take it as seriously as what you did? You know, did it take a bit of time? Was it just a bit of fun as an amateur at the time, or did you always have a desire to take it further as far as you obviously did?
Well, funny enough, we'd done it till, well, I'd done it until I was 16, 17, and then just went off the rails as you do. I was a teenager. But then I sort of got a young girl pregnant. I thought, oh, I need to get a job. I need to be doing something reputable, you know, for myself. So I ended up flying over to Northern Ireland and trying to do professional boxing. I thought I'd give it a shot. And I only went over as a sparring partner, sparring Paul Hodgkinson and Dave Boy McCauley. But they were great fighters, you know. Both of them great fighters. And it was tough, but I ended up doing that to bring proper, you know, some money in to pay the bills, because that's what we had to do. So it was tough.
Yeah. And what about, like, your amateur career then? How do you look back on that? Do you look back on it with fond memories? Was it a good being on the circuit? And, I mean, one of the things, fighting on the same bill as Nigel and your father as well, I mean, that was quite a unique thing, wasn't it? And you did that a few times around the circuit, so, you know, fighting on the same bill as your dad. I don't think, has anyone ever done that before?
I'm not too sure, but, I mean, I had 108 amateur fights, and I lost 13 of them. I lost three to, I think it was Tony Canellan. Or Darren Canelo, you know, one of them. And I lost three to that guy. I lost three to Dean Binch. These are great fighters, but he never done anything as pros. And the rest of them, don't get me wrong, I was lucky on a lot of them. I mean, I remember boxing Alan Levine. I boxed him 13 times, and I know I didn't win all them 13. I know that for a fact, you know. But I suppose that's boxing, isn't it? But I don't get me wrong, I did lose 13. I had 96 wins, so that wasn't too bad. I sort of enjoyed it because I boxed for England, Young England, and I won two national schoolboy titles. So I enjoyed it, but it was just a hobby, you know. But we didn't realise that we'd go on. They're just dreams when you think, oh, I'm going to go on, I'm going to become world champion, I'm going to do this. They're just dreams. They never, you know, you never think that they're ever going to come true. But they're always in the back of your mind, just in case they do, you know.
At what stage did you then, that dream or that became a reality and you said, yeah, I'm going to become pro? At what point did that you make that decision? Was it after you was amateur or during the end of your amateur career?
Oh, it was when I turned pro. And, you know, we were in a stable with Born Eastwood. Born Eastwood stable in Northern Ireland. He had Paul Hodgkinson. I mean, he had three, four, five world champions, and the gym was just full of classical fighters. Bernardo Checa was a trainer, was a fantastic trainer. Paul, you'd be sparring Paul Hodgkinson every day. I'd be sparring Dave Boy McCauley every day. Don't get me wrong, I hated sparring because you're in there. What, you know, this is different from amateur. Amateur, you're messing about. Professional sparring, you're in the ring. They were trying to pull chills in you. Dave Boy McCauley, great fighter. Paul Hodgkinson, great fighter. I had to survive every day sparring them guys, which I did. But life's life. I mean, Chris Santo was Spaniard. There's some great fighters there. You know, Victor Cordova, he's a super middleweight champion. You know, so there was some great fighters there. But it's sort of, you sort of get used to sitting on their level, even though you're not world champion. You get used to it because every fighter in that gym was a fantastic fighter, and you could see was a classical fighter. You know, Eamon McCauley, you know, there was some, you know, Sam, I forgot his name, but there's quite a few of the guys there were really great fighters. And we'd just, so every, you know, we'd walk around that gym and we just thoroughly enjoyed it. And it would be every day, you know, from 9 o'clock in the morning, we'd be in a money minibus, straight into the gym, start training, and then have one session a day and then go home and relax for 6 days a week. It was pretty good. We enjoyed it. And, you know, obviously, BJ Eastwood, he, God bless him, he died the other month. But rest in peace, BJ. He was a great manager and promoter. Yeah, a lot of his influence through financial, but he was a clever businessman the way he'd done it. And he used to promote the shows himself and put them on Ulster TV. Pretty good. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed that career, and I thought it was the correct decision I made to do that, go there.
Signing over with them, yeah, and you did go with Barney Eastwood. Yeah, I remember that was a great camp, and Hodgkinson was coming through. Liverpool boxing was really thriving at that time. 1988, Richie, your professional debut. It was a great time for the city, wasn't it? And like you said, Barney Eastwood camp. Just take us back to that 1988, your professional debut looming.
Well, I did fight Miguel Matthews, but on that bill, there was Paul Hodgkinson defending his British title. There was Fran Arden, fantastic fighter. Andy Olligan, another fantastic fighter. And Nigel Wenton obviously was on there, and one or two of the South Americans. So the bill was an extraordinary bill in Kirby. And I remember going out to it thinking, oh, this is my first fight. I said to Eastwood, I said, what, you know, is he good? And he said, don't worry about it. Just do what you've got to do. In other words, and I thought, because I was quite wary of it, first pro fight. And I found it I won't say easy. No fight is easy, don't get me wrong. Just walking to that ring is hard. And when you get in that ring, it's hard. But when you fight, that's when you know, you're sort of relaxed because you're letting all the adrenaline go then. And you're in there and you just do what you've got to do. And don't get me wrong, Miguel Matthews is one of the, you know, uncrowned champions as an opponent, but he was a great fighter. That's all I can say. He's done a lot in the professional boxing trade.
When you look back then at your early part of your career, the learning fights, and you spent a lot of time fighting in Belfast as well. Was you sort of living over there while you was in training camp? They had all the facilities over there to take it, but a lot of your fights were there early. How do you look back on all them early fights? I mean, up until like the one you lost against Floyd Churchill. But there was one fight in particular, and you mentioned it earlier, it was the Mark Johnson one. I believe that was Mark Johnson, was your sixth fight. So Mark Johnson went on to become a world champion, but also in the Hall of Fame as well, he became a great fighter. And you had that in your sixth fight. You mentioned what a great opponent he was as well. But, you know, you had a good early learning career, them first fights. You was brought along well, really, wasn't you?
Don't get me wrong. I mean, BJ Eastwood, he was a clever guy. Eddie Shaw was the trainer with Bernardo Checker and John Breen. Another great trainer. But when the fight got introduced, is because I was sparring Dave Boy McCauley. Dave Boy McCauley was due to defend his title against a kid. I forgot the guy's name from the USA. And the guy was a great fighter. But his sparring partner wanted to fight me. So I said, okay, he's only had two fights or one fight. I've had six fights unbeaten. And in reality, I was a bit heavy. I was like sort of 8'6" to 8'10". This guy was like 8'2", soaking wet, you know. So obviously this guy had a big name behind him and what he was going to achieve. And all of a sudden, I mean, that fight was quite integral for me because I learned so much from that fight that just for the fact that, you know, as soon as that bell goes, you've got to be alert. You can't just walk out there and think, oh, here we go again. It's not one of them. You've got to go out there and you've got to have your eyes open. You've got to see exactly what it's all about. And you can run, you can chase him, or he can chase you. Or, you know, you've got to see exactly how he works against you for you to fight. And I just thought he was a super fighter when he boxed me. In fact, I've got it on video. It's a poor copy, but I'll put it on YouTube soon. I was going to send it to Mark Too Sharp Johnson, but I don't. Obviously, he's not happy with the fact that I beat him. But we're friends now. You see, he's over in the States and he's got his own gym. He does really well. But yeah, I learned a lot from that fight. But there's fights that my second pro fight, I boxed a kid named Sean Casey. And he put me down three times in a four-round fight. And I swear to God, I'd never been put down in my life. Well, like that anyway. And I just thought, I had to get up and I had to win it. So obviously I won. He put me down twice in one round. It wasn't three times. It was twice in one round he put me down. That was it. But I won the other three rounds. So obviously it was one of them. So I won it. But can we fuck that one off? Because I shouldn't have really spoke about that. Because it was an awful fight. It was me. It was a shit fight. Chris, can you edit this?
Well, you took him on again, though, Sean Casey, didn't you? You fought him again later on.
And even then, I swear to God, even then, the guy was like a jinx. You know, like it's like Liverpool versus Everton. It's like Liverpool are far better than Everton. Yeah. But when they play each other, it's like a jinx team, isn't it? Exactly. You know, it's like a jinx. Everton can easily beat Liverpool, you know, and they don't even need to try. Yeah. Yeah. But he can get something out of it. And that's what he got out of it. He got the draw out of it, but he didn't get a draw. I obviously won it. But excuse me.
Yeah. It's all right. But it's one of them that does your head in, like one of them fight. Yeah, one of them ones that does. I mentioned there Floyd Churchill. That was your first time you've tasted defeat.
Do you know that fight? You know, it really upset me, that fight. I got that fight on video. Someone sent me that fight the other month and I seen it. And there's no way in a million years the referee should have stopped that fight. There's no way. I'm absolutely shocked that the referee did stop that fight. In fact, I'm going to put that on YouTube as well so they can see that. But other than that, don't get me wrong, the guy could punch, and he did have a bit of weight on me. I'm not bothered about that, you know. He had a bit of weight on me, but that's life, innit? I had a lot more experience, but didn't use it to my ability, you know. I just thought, it was a world title build. You know, Colin McMillan was, I think he was defending his world title. So I was on that bill, and I should have just come out and just done what I'd done, but he's a great... He was a strong puncher. And I remember him. All I can basically remember is having my hands up and just trying to block a couple of shots. That's all I was doing, blocking a couple of shots. But they were getting through. They were getting through my guard. And I was thinking, what? So, and one of them, boom, must have put me down. I got straight back up and said, whoa, okay. So I hadn't been put down. I was unbeaten then, you see. So I was quite shocked and surprised. So... is that bullshit, isn't it? Yeah.
Local derby that as well, and he was a scouser as well, wasn't he?
But I didn't even know that yet, but he's an American scouser, wasn't he?
Was he?
Because he lived in America, didn't he? I think he's from the USA and he moved to the UK, to Liverpool. That's what I think. Listen, I've got nothing against any of the guys I've boxed. I'm just grateful that, you know, everyone is good friends with everyone in this world now. especially, you know, the boxing game. You know, I meet guys. I mean, it's one of my closest friends, Alan Levine. What a guy. What a lovely guy. I mean, you see, there's fighters I see there that I boxed as amateurs, and I think, wow. And these are lovely guys. And they've got enough respect for everyone. And respect is right up through, on the card, you know, through everything. You know, and I just value that. I think that's great. Even now, I work offshore now. In oil and gas, and I'm going on oil rig, and there's young kids there don't even know what it's like to show people respect, because they've had no respect all their life. And you just think, fucking hell, sorry about swearing, but bullshit, you know. I just think it's bull, you know. I don't respect them, you know, because they don't respect me. So, you know, that's life, isn't it? I just get on with my life and try and do the best I can. By the way, I'm going to bring an app out. I'm putting an app out, you know, Chris. I'm bringing an app out in the next...
Tell me about it.
The next 6 weeks, I'm bringing an app out. And, you know, because this lockdown, because I've been working in oil and gas offshore, and it's been all frozen because, they're only using essential maintenance packages. So not many people have been getting off. But anyway, we decided, me and my mate phoned me up, said, Richie, said, should we do something, doing that? I said, okay, yeah, what do you want to do? He said, let's do this this community events, dating app. I said, okay. So we got into it. So we are doing an app which is just solely dedicated to the LGBTQ plus community. And we're going to support the ladies. So it's going to be, it'll be pretty good. It's going to have an events package in there. It's going to have the community. It's going to have community packaging there. It's going to be really good for the women and obviously dating. So, but it's only going to be for the LGBTQ community, which I'm really looking forward to getting out and see where it goes. We're going to support them. We are going to support them because I don't think they've had a fair bite of the cherry in these in this modern age. I mean, we're in 2020. You know, we're not in 1912 or, you know, 200 years ago. We're in 2020. And these are not getting a fair deal. So, as far as I'm concerned, I said, yeah, I'll join in. I'll give you a hand and I will help you promote it and go from there. So that's what we're doing now.
I wish you very best of luck with it.
Cheers. Let me on the glass. You've got to cool my nerves.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, you go for it, mate. You know where... You mentioned how you work offshore. Have you done that for years? And Richie, since you quit boxing, have you had a few jobs over the years?
I retired from boxing in 2001. I got beat against Scott Harrison from Scotland. Well, it was on Sheffield, but I got beat against him. So I didn't know what to do. And I thought, well, I'm not going to go around being a punch bag for anyone. So I'm just going to hang my gloves up. So I actually thought, I'm going to go to college and I'm going to learn, because I was buying and selling houses at the time. And I thought, you know, what cost me the most all the time is the electricians. They charge me in 2001, it's £2,500 to rewire a house, which is not a lot now. But then it was like, that was the biggest, that was the biggest factor in it. So I thought, I'll learn to be an electrician and I'll do it myself. However, I didn't realize that once you learn to be an electrician, you need the experience and then the qualifications and go from there. So I eventually got it in the end. And that's what I was doing for like 3 or 4 years. And then all of a sudden I got a phone call. One of the lads said, Richie, do you want to go offshore? I said, how much? He said, 300. And I thought £300 a week. I said, oh, go on then. So when it gets down up to Scotland, we're sitting there in a meeting and the lady said, it's £300 a day. And I went, ugh. I nearly choked on me pencil case. So it's just one of them things, you know what I mean? And I just thought, great, let's get it on. And just bingo, went out there and done it. And I've been doing that for years, since 2006 now. However, I haven't been offshore since last November, 2019, but I'm going to try and change my career and I'm going to go on this. cheeky, get him on there.
Yeah, give it a go. So, I mean, you know, when you're working offshore and that, you mentioned there about some of the youngsters and that. Did these people know that you was an ex-champion and one of the top boxers of the country at one point?
Yeah, but the thing is, don't get me wrong. Yeah, I mean, but once you're on that platform, you're on a platform for maybe just say between 6 months or 18 months or even 2 years, and you're on there and you see these guys. More than you see your wife or you see your kids or you see your family. And so you're bumping into them every day. And if you have to work with them, well, then you have to work with them. So, you know, you're seeing them for 12 hours a day. You work 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, which is common in the North Sea. So, and it's for 14 days in a month. So you're doing 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off. And you think, oh. But, yeah, a lot of people did stop me and say hello. And don't get me wrong, there's a lot of respect. Lovely folk offshore, and who appreciate good people and what people have achieved in their past lives. So yeah, but other than that, I've sort of had enough of working offshore. In fact, I've had enough of being an electrician. I hate it. but yeah, do you know what? I went down the gym, tonight. I've just been down the gym, right? I've been promising these few kids. In Dynamite, Regan Denton's gym, the Hood, which is in Sheffield. I've been down there to sparring tonight, and I haven't sparred for 5-10 years. So anyway, I goes down there, gets me gear on, got me sparring gloves on, and Regan gets two girls and this little guy, and they're only kids, so only between 16 and 18. So anyway, I said to them before I got in there, I said, listen, if you don't punch me hard, I'm going to punch you hard, right? Only so they would, so just so I can see what they've got and let them hit me out. I'm not bothered about slipping a few shots. I wouldn't, hopefully I didn't count on taking any shots because I was always going to be distant. halfway through the first round with this kid, right? He's only young as well, right? I started thinking, oh my God. I'm gonna find myself on the floor in a minute. Time. So cool time. I said, what? So I said, you don't have to go that hard, just one of them things. I went, shit, I started to think, I'm looking at the lights and I went, what? So yeah, I don't mind going down to the Hood, which is in Sheffield, and doing a bit of sparring with the kids. Only to teach them moving. I don't hit them, I just probably just touch them and block shots. And show them footwork, show them how to cut the ring off, show them, how to feint, how to slip, how to move, how to punch, and just be relaxed. So that's what I'm going to be doing now in my spare time. But I haven't got much spare time.
Do you do much training?
I know this is a shit interview, right? But you know what? I'll do another one and it'll be a million times better. It's just that I'm not focused or nothing. I'm just, and I'm not... pissed either. This is my first glass.
Richie, yeah. This is a fucking fantastic interview. It's a fantastic interview, seriously. And all this, I'll cut all this anyway because I'm going to edit this so it's mint and I've got Tommy. So listen, I'll relax with you. And listen, if it's any consolation, look, me and you've got a mutual mate in Tommy, aren't we? You're having a glass of wine. Listen, I'm rolling a joint here, so... So if that puts you at ease a little bit, right? So, we'll cut all this out, but I forgot what I was going to say.
Chris, do you know if I just talk normal, right? I'm not bad, I'm all right giving it all out, but do you know when I'm under pressure? I mean, I only had that sat there, that glass. In fact, I've got the bloody bottle. You can see how much I've got the bottle there.
I wish I had one myself, mate. Honest, I wish I had one myself. I've got a cup of tea here. I sat down and I thought, I'm rushing. And I rolled a joint quick, had it at the back door, running here, stuck the thing on, got you on here. And then I'm here now talking to you about like someone who I used to watch as a young lad about things. So, honest, it's going down a fucking storm for me, this.
Do you know that fight against Graham O'Malley, by the way? You know, he's died now, don't you? But you know that Graham O'Malley? Wow, I tell you what, I'd gone down there thinking that was going to be an easy fight. And even though he was an opponent, that guy gave me one tough fight. In fact, I was nearly thinking, whoa. Do you know what? Another thing I've put on social media, and this has really sort of got me thinking, and with due respect, I haven't seen the Dubois fight, but I can imagine that Joe Joyce did outbox him and did beat him up, right? Now, do you know what? Do you know what I've put on social media, right, Chris? I've put on there, right? What's all this bullshit about Dubois quitting, right? And then I've put down, I quit 3 times in 31 pro fights. And do you know the reason why I quit? I didn't say it, right? But the reason why I quit was for the fact that I knew I wasn't going to win that fight when I was in. You sort of know after 2 or 3 rounds whether you're going to win that fight, right? You sort of know, right? And Dubois had done what? 10 rounds. And he'd been getting beat over 10, but beat up. His eye was closed. I just thought, what? I would have been out of that ring as soon as that eye had swelled up and I knew I wasn't going to win. You can't just go on a lucky punch. You know, don't get me wrong, you've got a puncher's chance. Well, fucking hell, when does anyone get a luck puncher's chance? How many fights have you seen do that? I mean, don't get me wrong, the only reason why I beat Paul Lloyd was because I broke him in the changing rooms and in the ring. I broke his heart. I let him love all the commotion in that hall and let him all his fans cheering and all booing me. And I went, okay, you can have all that, you know. But it's just, all it is just going to wind me up. And I showed him no respect whatsoever because he didn't show me any respect. So why should I show him respect? I'm a champion. You don't boo a champion when a champion gets introduced. I was the champion. And the crowd booed me. I went, what? So I thought, that's why I jumped onto the ropes and I said, I'm going to beat your man up. I'm going to beat your man up. Easy as that. And you know what? With that, my mind was focused on a fight. I knew he's an awkward style for me to win because his style was not the best style for me. I looked him on a video before I even watched it. I thought, oh, shit, going to be in a bit of trouble here. You know what I mean? As you do. But I'll see how it goes. But anyway, cut a long story short, I'm in there. I thought, well, do you know what? He's doing this. He's doing this because that's all he was doing. And he's weighing me up and catching me with all kinds of shots. I thought, forget that. Let's fight. Let's do it like a man's fight. Let's fight. So I dragged him into my fight. And just thought, come on, if you want to fight, let's fight. So that was it. That's how it worked. That's how it went. That's how it happened. And I won. Lucky enough.
There's the champion, Richie Wenton, silver, David Brenner, Nicky Piper, and ringside for you. Round one.
Superb right hand straight away there from Wenton. Good depth for this fight.
Well, Wenton, we know, courage and abundance. We just wonder whether Lloyd has ever been tested as he will be tested tonight. Don't think he's ever gone beyond 6 rounds as Paul Lloyd. This is one big hurdle for him to clear.
Yeah, that'll be a decisive factor when it starts going into later stages, whether he can do the distance from the big thing.
Well, they can both bang a bit, these boys. Start from the champion, Richie Wenton. As we've so often said in the past, to win a title, you've got to go out and demonstrably beat the champion, like Stevie Collins did last week. That's what Paul Lloyd has to do here in Chester tonight.
Good left touch from both boys there. They both landed. Wenton's getting the better things in the first
round. Yes, good start from Wenton.
Come on.
It's amazing how the crowd can affect a fight. They really get their men going.
They certainly do. And each one of them is a tactical expert. We've got 4,000 coaches at ringside tonight. Yeah. That's a good shot. Down. Right hand, and he's down. John Coyle lets him box on. He did touch down then. Round one. It was the right hand that started it. And he's in trouble, Lloyd. Yeah. This is a big round for the champion. No knockdown, just a slip. No knockdown. Oh, good left hook from Wenton. Got him down. Down again. The bell has gone. He was up at three. Two knockdowns in that round. Very definitely Richie Wenton's round.
His legs are still wobbling when he walked back the corner there. And I don't think Lloyd... This won't go the distance. I'd be very surprised if Lloyd can do 12 hard rounds at this pace after taking a first round beating like he just did.
To take the full eight.
A bit eager there, Wenton. He's going to get through with these punches. Lloyd starts to mix it.
Caught him again with a right hand. And Lloyd is all over the place at the moment. He's just walking into shots.
They're both trading. If either one of them lands, the other's going to go over.
This is tremendous stuff. This is worthy of a title fight.
Unbelievable bravery.
Oh, Lloyd is within a whisker of going down. And he caught Wenton then.
Well, as I say, they're both Wenton is reckless.
The left eye has gone now. Lloyd's left eye cut, bleeding. Round two. And the legs look like Bambi in there. Well, this is one of the great championship rounds I think I've seen in many a move. Inside the last 20.
Oh!
How Lloyd was managing to keep upright, I do not know. Time to get Lloyd patched up and out again, and he still doesn't look that great. The other little warning from ringside, people to take their seats. It's like the rush hour around ringside. Round three.
It very rarely happens, Dave, but sometimes a boxer can go down once or twice in the early fight and then actually seem to get used to the opponent's punches and take them better.
Well, maybe so, but I don't think that... There's no way that I can hold up for 12 rounds.
No, I don't think so. But Wenton is being reckless, and this could still go either way. Wenton seemed to do the same against Neil Swain when they fought last year. And for five rounds went non-stop assault. And then finally was worn out. He's worn himself out.
Well, maybe the circumstances of that fight slightly different to the circumstances of this, because Wenton looks supremely confident and supremely up for this.
Oh, he's up for it, that's for sure.
Good comeback, though, by Lloyd, trying to get the jab to work. Well, if you're not fit going into a title fight, you're a fool yourself. Much better round. much better round for the challenger. Wenton up and ready.
Seconds out, round four.
Fourth round. Those opening two rounds, which John Coyle, I'm sure, will have given to him on a 10-9 margin, given him a useful cushion. But every time Wenton tries to throw a big right, it's getting through. And the problem is, with that left eye damage, Lloyd just can't see it coming. Oh, good right hand. And that almost... And Lloyd off his feet. This, I feel, will be the punch that wins the fight for Wenton. And these thudding right hands, each one zeroing in on the damaged eye. But then, security doing a pretty good job on the crowd, happily. Fifth round. Wenton, the champion in the silver. Lloyd, the challenger in the black. John Coyle giving a superlative performance refereeing this contest.
Both landed good punches. I wouldn't bet on it, Dave, obviously, but I've got a feeling that Lloyd may cause a shock here. Everything's gone against him, but Wenton's, as I said, so reckless.
Well, he's still upright. He can still pull off a surprise. Oh, goodness. Oh, goodness. And the tragedy is for Lloyd, he's the only one in the hall who can't see them coming. To give ground, and the right hand is cocked, and Wenton driving him around the ring, tries a right uppercut, doesn't quite connect.
And Wenton knows that right hand is a punch.
Well, I did say this would be the decisive punch. It could be. Once again, Lloyd's head is jerked back. Oh, he's got him down with a left hook.
Desperate.
He's up at nine, but for how long? And will John Coyle let it continue? I don't think so. It's all over. It's all over. In round five, Wenton has won on a fifth round stoppage. The crowd stunned. They can hardly believe it. Look at that four. A crowd reacting to defeat, and look at that, to a corner reacting to a win. Superb performance from Wenton. And we will be talking to Richie Wenton in a moment. And, well, why some are booing, I do not know. This is how it finished, Nicky.
Oh, it was unbelievable fighting. Great punches. He knew the right hand was the one.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the 2 minutes, 25 seconds of round five, the referee, John Coyle, has stopped the contest. Paul Lloyd being in no continue. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner and still the Bantamweight champion, Richie Wenton.
Magnificent performance from Wenton. He took on Lloyd, he took on the crowd, he beat them both.
And ladies and gentlemen, your appreciation please for a young man who's taken part in what must be one of the fights of the year, Paul Nigel Lloyd, a tremendous effort.
I say, we will be talking to Richie Wenton after the break. I've got Richie Wenton with me. That is the belt. Richie, you went out, you met fire with fire tonight.
I'm the champion of Great Britain. I'm number one in Europe. I'm number two in the Commonwealth. I'm number one in Great Britain. And that's the man's behind me, basically, I think. I mean, there's two people I'd like to thank before I say anything, you know, and that's Senior Sam Adair down in North Devon, who's my mentor for this fight. Plus, I'd like to thank the British Boxing Board Control for keeping my rankings as 1-1-2, one in Britain, one in Europe, and two in the Commonwealth. And, you know, and I'm going on to bigger and better things now. Maybe Naseem Hamed, maybe take the European title fight, defense title fight, you know, against the European Super Bantamweight title. I'm number one Super Bantamweight in Great Britain, and let's see anyone take it off me.
Now, listen, this must have been like coming into the Lions' den for you tonight.
Well, you heard the crowd. You're the experience for the crowd. You know, I've done a job.
Richie, and I went from there.
Listen,
the only woman
see this girl?
We did it.
This girl is
we
one
did
of,
it,
you
Dad.
Know.
We did it.
She's part of the mentor with Senior Sam Adair. Plus me training Sam Adair. There's too many people I'd have to thank you. You know, I'd have to be here all day. But, you know, I've done it, and I've done it for Liverpool and Devon.
Well, look, we're going to show you how it started now, the first round. Talk us through the first round. Watch on the screen then.
He's a nice mover. I was looking at him. He can't usually take a punch. He's open for right hands. And the only way I could catch him was to slip and counter punch him. And I wasn't going to let him off the hook as soon as I caught him. Yeah, he was trying to...
And this is how you finished it.
Yeah, he hit him with a good right hand. I'm not going to do a Naseem Hamed and go, wow, look at that, dig it. I'm not a Naseem Hamed, I'm going to say, I've done a boxing, I've done a talking in a ring, and that's that, you know.
Was there any doubt in your mind that this was the way the fight would go?
No, I honestly went in to do a 12-rounder. That was the pace I was going to fight, a 12-round fight. You know, I had to take a few shots to get in there. I've been out the ring 5 months. I'm the champion of Great Britain, and I proved it. I showed my experience and my class tonight.
And what does that Lonsdale belt mean to you?
Too much. It means too much. The kid's going to have to knock me out and keep me on the floor for him to take this belt off me. Anyone is going to have to destroy me to take this belt off me. That fight was his last fight. I dedicate that fight to Bradley Stone and his family. And he never lost to a plum fighter, which he showed me last fight against Neil Swain. He lost to a champion.
Well, Richard, you proved a lot of things to a lot of people tonight. Well done. Well done, the fans.
Yeah!
I think that's a good point to leave it.
You know what happened with that, right? You know, Paul Lloyd said to me, he started slagging me in the newspapers all saying, Richie, the best thing you better do is get him back in the ring, all this, all that. All because he wanted to fight me, he wanted to challenge me and all that. I said no. And then I remember putting something in the newspapers that said, because there was in the Liverpool Echo, they had in there with, you know, people's views and what people writing in saying things. And someone had put down there, Richie Wenton, if you feel that this is the easy fight, because I just said, well, this will be an easy fight for me. You know, I was only playing mind games. And someone had put in there, Richie, if you feel this is an easy fight, an easy money, why don't you take it? And I thought, well. So I sort of thought, well, it's not looking good now, is it? I'm going to have to take it. So I did. And... that's why I thought, I mean, I should never have boxed him, but as I say, I wouldn't have got to where I got to without beating him. So I just went from there. But other than that, it said bullshit about me. It said, you're better off just getting back in the ring, Richie, after all the Bradley Stone and all that. I thought, is he think he's talking to? Do you know what I mean? And I thought, Jesus, that's wrong. You can't be talking like that. He had nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with him. It's nothing to do with my feelings or anyone else's feelings, you know, what he's thinking. I don't care what he's no one. He's just a guy. He just wants to fight me. Well, he did, and that's what happened. Excuse me.
To get to that fight and how you performed on that night against Lloyd, you'd had to go through a lot to get to that point. You'd become British champion in tragic circumstances. As well, when in that fight with Bradley Stone, it was an hard time for you. That I know it was, Richie, and you moved down to Biddeford for a while, and you had that fight with Neil Swain You had that loss. So going into that fight, he was a real underdog, but it was probably, you know, it was a night when you really shone. But just take us back to that time in your life. And I mean, the fight with Bradley Stone was, but again, that was a good fight, and Bradley Stone put up a great fight.
You know, Bradley Stone was a great, great fighter, right? And I was fortunate to win. Thing is, I didn't even contemplate thinking I was going to win that fight because he had home advantage. It was in, obviously, he'd had the crowd there. I just had a few people in there. That was it. Just maybe a handful of people. That was it. And I knew all the crowd were on his side. He had the referee. He had Mickey Duff there. And I phoned Frank. I said, Frank, any chance you can corner me? And, I was Dave Lewis at the time I spoke to. And Dave Lewis said, I'll ask Frank. Next thing is he gets a phone call back off Dave Lewis. Said, yeah, Frank said he will go in your corner. So that's the reason why. So I wanted enough backup in my corner as Bradley Stone had in his corner. And he had Mickey Duff with Terry Lawless and some other big names. And I was thinking, who have I got? And don't get me wrong, I've got nothing against Glenn Rhodes or Heddlebomb Graham, but at the time, they were the big names for me. But I wanted someone bigger, as it just in boxing as for TV. And that was, Frank Warren. And Frank said, yeah, I'll go in your corner. And you know what the good thing about it? He did go in the corner. And he did give some words of advice. And, you know, as to the fight, I mean, don't get me wrong. I got put down in round 8 of this fight and with the Bradley Stone fight. And I remember looking up at the lights and I was thinking, he nearly took the roof off. I got up slowly and I thought, God, I'm all over the place here. Can't even feel my legs. And you know, when you wake up in the morning, that's how much strength I had. And I thought, God, I couldn't even make a fist. But I had to run. I had to survive. And I survived. I was lucky enough to survive and win the fight in round 10. After that, obviously, I didn't realise what had happened. And I basically went back down to Columpton, where I was living at the time, and slept there. Next morning, I thought, oh, I've just won a British title. I thought, I'm going to go onto the phone. So I went onto the phone to one of the newspapers and left a note in the door. And I thought, oh, and it was a national newspapers. I think it was the Daily Mirror. I'd left a note through the letterbox, and you know, in the cottage I was staying in, and because I went out for a walk and I was showing the belt off about 8 o'clock in the morning in Columpton. Cars were just stopping in the middle of the road because there's one road right through Columpton, and I was there just, and people were stopping and getting out of the cars to look at the belts, and well, you know, it was all happy for me and all that. So it gets back to the cottage about 8, 9 o'clock. And I guess there's this note, little card on the floor says, can you, someone's name? And then it said the Daily Mirror or something like that. So I went to the phone box thinking, oh, here we go. They want to give me, I'll do an interview, I'll do this. So, you know, I'm champion now, I've done this. And I phoned the guy up because I didn't have a mobile phone then. I phoned the journalist up and I said, I've done this and I've done that. And this is what I'm going to do and this is what I'm going to do. And he said, Richie, haven't you heard? I said, heard what? And he said, Bradley Stone's in hospital. Boom. I put the phone down. I was absolutely devastated. The first person I phoned was Frank Warren. And believe it or not, he answered the phone first time, which is not usually a Frank. And I spoke to Frank and I just went on from there. But the rest is history. So I don't really like looking back on that. It's obviously a devastating time in everyone's lives who was associated with it. So, you know, I just go forward now and try not to look back. But other than that, the Neil Swain fight was, I mean, don't get me wrong, I shouldn't have even read newspapers and the media because they sort of controlled me and I thought, I sort of didn't like that. And so I've just went on and went from there, but I did. I got fucking squeezed up with newspapers and shit, and you know, front page, there was some, oh yeah, middle page, yeah, you know, all that bullshit. And I thought, okay, yeah. So, and then all of a sudden there was the Neil Swain fight, and it should have been just a warm-up fight, normal six-round fight. And the thing is, when he was getting off, I was in a different changing room than Bradley, and he come up to see me to say goodbye, and which is really nice. And I shook his hand, gave him a cuddle in there, and obviously we wanted photos, so we had a photo together. And I think I said to him, I said, you know, because he was a great fighter, he had a great record. And I said to him, I said, you know, this has only just come out, this belt now, so, you know, they will have different titles, different belts there for it. So if I was you, I'd just keep on going, I'd keep on carrying on. Because he did say he was just considering his future in boxing. But he didn't know what he was going to do. So I gave him a cuddle in there, and basically that was it. Said goodbye, and that was the last I've seen him. But what a lovely guy. What a lovely, honest. And he was a quiet guy. You know what I mean? Even at the weigh-in and at the check-in weigh-in, you know, we met up. We didn't have no bad words or nothing like that. We were just professionals in every aspect of the situation. So we did, and that was it. And then all of a sudden, there was the Neil Swain fight. And it should have been just a warm-up fight, normal six-round fight. And I just didn't fancy the fight. I didn't fancy fighting. I just didn't fancy fighting. And I just didn't even want to be in that ring, you know, even though I was sort of number one in Europe at the time, because the Super Bantamweight title had just come out in Europe as well, the European Super Bantamweight Championship. So I just thought I wasn't really bothered. So I treat it with content, which is crazy. And when I remember being in the ring, and I could see he wasn't the best fighter, but he was a decent fighter. He won a Commonwealth title. But I walked away from the fight when I was in the fight. About round four or five, I just walked away. However, I realised several weeks later that was my livelihood. That was me. That was my life. That was the only way I could earn a living. And I know that Di Gardner had put in a contract. It was a contractual fight. He's going to fight, retain fight. but he'd never fight me again. He would never, ever, Neil Swain would never fight me again. And I always wanted that fight. And I waited weeks, if not months, for him to sign. But he'd never sign over. So I sort of sued him. Okay, it's only 5,000 quid, but I sued him for 5,000 quid because Neil Swain wouldn't fight me. He wouldn't allow Neil Swain to fight me. So I said, okay, fine. But it was Frank looking after that. Frank Warren. But after that, then there was the defence of the British title, and I thought, Jesus, I'm going to lose this. I'm going to lose everything I've got here if I lose this fight now. I'm going to just be a normal, just back down the ladder. And I think I've tried too hard. I've climbed this ladder too high to fucking go back down. So I thought, I'm going straight up. And I trained, I must admit, Samadir, I changed me training staff, right? I had Samadir and Babs Spears from North Devon. And with due respect, I must admit, Sam, yeah, he's rough and ready, but you know what? The guy, he sort of made me believe in myself. He sort of made me believe in myself. But not only that, the thing is, he was a sort of, he trained like a madman. He trained me like a madman. So I was sort of the fittest I'd ever been in my life, but not technically, not on skill, but on fitness. So I was the fittest I'd ever been for a fight. That's why I couldn't even sweat on that when I'd done five rounds with Paul Lloyd. So yeah, and he trained me every single day. I'd be running up a beach hill, you know, sand hill, and you know, it was killing me. I even done it, you know, I'd be running every day, and he would overtrain you, so you'd have to go through that overtrain and keep on going and keep on going. Yeah, I probably ate good food and obviously took some supplements to keep me strong, my salts and that. And then come the fight, I couldn't afford to have lost that fight. Otherwise, everything would have been in vain when it comes to winning the British title. And I thought, fuck that. Sorry.
Was there a moment, Richie, when there was a mind shift, when in between the Neil Swain fight and the Paul Lloyd, where you knew, yeah, I'm ready to go in there again and turn it on properly, you know, and what gave you that mental strength to do that, to perform that like you did on that night?
I'll tell you now. Well, I moved out of that cottage, right? I was renting a cottage, a fantastic cottage, and I moved out after I beat the Bradley Stone. After I beat Bradley Stone, I moved out. And then I moved into like a rented place, and I was only using it temporary so I could buy somewhere later on. But after the Neil Swain fight, I was in this little dump of a flat. And I thought, God, is this what I've become? I've got a British title, I've got a Lonsdale belt here. And I'm in a, like a little stinking, smelly, horrible little flat. Is this me? I thought, wow, no. So I changed all my training and stuff, and my coaches and that, and my sparring partners, and moved up with Sam Adair. Sam Adair was a wealthy guy, and I realised then that after the Neil Swain fight, after I got beat by Neil Swain, I was still in this flat, and I thought, you know, what am I doing here? So anyway, cut a long story short, I moved up with Sam Adair, and that guy trained me, and that guy influenced me. That guy mentally, I mean, made give me self-confidence to myself and say, that's how good a fighter you are. Go out and do it. And that's all you have to do. And I did. I just went out and done it. But he trained me really hard. I mean, nothing said about this guy ever. And he should be given a lot of plaudits, because I've got a lot of time, a lot of respect for him. You know, but there's nothing I can say. All I can say is that he was a great trainer and a great, great guy. You know.
Where was his gym, Richard?
Well, we used to use a Biddeford one in Biddeford. You know, where Dick Casey, as well as, you know, the rest of them up there. And I used to have sparring partners. I had sparring partners. These are guys on the door. These are big guys on the door of boozers. And I used to have to get in and spar them. And these are Xboxes and all that. And I'm coming in just to have a rough. And I'm thinking, Jesus. So I'm sparring these guys. And these are big guys. Okay, yeah, I'm punching holes in them. But you know what? You're thinking, fucking hell, they're catching me. I'm boom. You know, so they're catching me at the same time as well, and me catching them. And it was quite tough. That was the only sparring I could do. So none of them were my weight. They were all quite big guys, and I was thinking, Jesus. But I got through it, and it made me stronger for the person I am. So once I got in that ring with Paul Lloyd, I just walked through him, because I was used to fighting bigger guys. And toe to toe. That's what got me through that.
Tommy Dix always says to me, he said to you, I mean, Tom, we have a mutual friend in Tommy Dix. He knew your dad when your dad was young, and he knew you too when you were nippers, you were nice. He always says to me that night, he said to you, leave him waiting, then go into the ring and say, you're on your own now, and you're here. But you look so confident when you danced around that ring that night. You know, how confident was you of winning that fight? Was you calmly confident? Was you very, you know, pent up? What was your emotions?
I wasn't confident at all. I sat down. Do you know what they've done? They put us in a room next to a swimming pool, right? Where you get changed in a swimming pool, right? So we had all the chlorine coming into our lungs. Well, I did anyway. And I'm due to fight, defend my British title. And I thought, this is not right. So I asked Sam, I said, Sam, ask them to change rooms, because I'm not getting changed here. I'm not getting ready for the fight here. So they put us in a big gym. So anyway, we're in this big gym, which is underneath the stadium, right, where all the fighting was. and I could hear the crowd, Lloydy, Lloydy. And I just thought, ugh. But anyway, there was no glory in here, so I was happy with that. But I never thought I was going to win that fight. Any fight I go in, you sort of got an element of doubt. So I sat in that gym, and my dad come down and said hello and so on and so forth. And then Sam just walked me around the gym. He said, Richie, just go out and do what you've got to do. You're a good fighter. You're a great fighter. Go out and do it. Just show them what you've got. And so I did. But what annoyed me was the fact that I could hear them all screaming, Lloyd, and then jumping up and down, banging on the floor. So I was thinking, I feel like a bloody gladiator about to just go into the arena to death, to die. So I thought, man, you know, it's not going to happen for me. So I remember the TV man come down. He said, the editor come down, banged on the doors. And he said, you ready to come yet? He said, I've said no. And Sam shouted out to me, he said, you ready to go? I said, no. And then the TV man said, well, we're going to have to cancel a fight. And I said, well, cancel a fucking fight. I said, I'm not coming down yet. You know, so I did keep him waiting for 3 or 4 minutes, only because I wasn't ready to go. I wasn't ready to go out there and do what I had to do. And they weren't going to cancel a fight. I knew that. So I just sat back and just took it and just thought, I'll go when I'm ready. Goes up there. I remember walking through all the crowds of people that were all outside the changes and right all the way through. And one of them was Curtis Warren, believe it or not, yeah. And he said, Richie, and he's from Toxteth, where I'm from. And he said, Richie, he said, go and show them what you're made of, lad. I went, phew. So anyway, so that was just a little bit of a boost there. And obviously, my training staff there and the crowd, and don't get me wrong, a lot of the, most of the, 90% of the crowd were all his crowd. But I had family there, I had friends there. I could see, and they were nice faces. When you see someone nice faces, you think, I'm going to do it for you. I'm going to do it for all yous, you know, which you do. And I remember just thinking, I'm in there now, and just got in the ring, and thought, this is my, now he's in my game now. This is me, this is my time. And, but when he, I was focused, you could see I was focused. If you look at my eyes, I'm focused. If, when the crowd started booming, though, when the MC was introducing me, I thought, how rude is that? That's rude. That's not right, you know. This guy's only had, what, a dozen fights, and he thinks he can fight me. I thought, no, come on. So anyway, that wound me up then. I thought, that's it. So I jumped on the ropes, and I went, I'm going to do your man, and I'm going to do it. And I did. And the first shot I threw on that fight, I remember my dad taught me one thing. He said, and this is quite important, because this was the great foundations of the win on this fight. Because, you know, the first shot, he was expecting me to come out and go, have a look at him and throw a jab. No, I just walked up there. I walked up to him. As soon as the bell went, walked up to him. First shot I threw with the biggest right hand I could wind up. He didn't even expect that. And I caught him. And he's gone, ooh. So that's put him, his mind all over the place. And I thought, well, come on, let's fight now. And if he didn't want to fight, he didn't want to fight, but he wanted to fight. So I come out better when I was fighting him. Do you know, this interview is pretty shit. So, do you know, I'm really, really sorry that I'm just hyped up about it. You know, it's just shit like that hypes me up when they talk about the Paul Lloyd fight, because that, it's not, my career was just not about that one fight. My career was about a great fight with some great fighters that were great fighters. And we're talking, these guys never even get known. And he's thinking, wow. I mean, Olympic bronze medalist was like, you know, a kid I boxed for the, from Guyana. Guyana, that's in obviously the Caribbean. And and the guy was a great fighter, but he was a very experienced fighter. I expected just to go in there and beat him up. And you know what? I thought, ooh. Well, I tried that. I thought, ooh. And he wobbled me once. I thought, cool. This guy's a pretty good fighter. But people don't get the recommendations they deserve doing a 12-round fight. I mean, don't get me wrong. It was heat to the summer. But I still went 12 rounds with him, and I won over 12 rounds. Michael Paris for the WBO Intercontinental Super Bantamweight title in Liverpool. That guy wasn't just a basically ordinary guy. He was a decent fighter. But people couldn't see. People don't see that. People don't see. Yeah, he might have been old, and well, that's the advantage you're taking it. It was good. But things like that. You look at some of them. Do you know what Barney Eastwood done? He got South American trainers and South American fighters to come across. And he's a Saul Mambi. Remember him? He's a guy who's come across just to spar us and give us, rub off what they've got onto us. I mean, you know, we used to learn off all them South Americans from Panama, Venezuela, Colombia, you name it, all them South Americans, and they were fantastic fighters. And we had to rub shoulders with them. We learn everything off them. You know, they'd be hitting the speedball like that, boom, 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 boom. They're using the elbows, they're using the heads. And we're thinking, wow. And I'm thinking like that, wow. And when they're skipping, they're just not just skipping. These are doing all this, and these are doing up and down. They're just doing it backwards. And I'm thinking, what? The very talented South American fighters. It's a bit like the Brazilian football team against the England football team. I won't say England, I say Ireland.
Yeah, but you learn a lot in that camp. I mean, yeah, like you say, that Paul Lloyd, Michael Paris, they were on the back of each other, them two wings, 1995, your British champion, your WBO Intercontinental champion. It's a great time in your career at that point. But take us back to that 1995, what it was like being champion there, on the verge of taking on Belcastro for the European.
Fantastic. You know, Vincenzo Belcastro, what a lovely little guy. And you know what? I don't think he should have won the fight. But the thing is, it was in a massive arena with only about 30 people there. And Barry Ayn, because I jumped from Frank Warren to Barry Ayn from there, and which Frank didn't like. But as I'm boxing, when I went for the first belt, it was just this little Italian guy, and I thought, oh, here we go. And I thought, well, Naseem Hamed beat him, so I must have an better chance of beating him, because I am. Well, I actually think, I wouldn't say I was better than Nas, but I'd say I was, I could see how he's beat him. I used to spar Naseem Hamed. If I can take all that bullshit out for me, because I shouldn't have said it, really. Can you take that out for me?
Which part, mate?
The part where I've said spar Naseem Hamed and all that. Just, you know.
That's dead interesting. It's really interesting, that, though. I mean, I would have asked you more about that.
Listen, me and Nas were sparred for fucking months. And, months and months and months. And you know what? It might have been on to the body. But Brendan Ingle wouldn't have it any other way. He wouldn't have it any other way. The only time he'd have any other way is when I was starting moaning and say, I need open sparring. I need open sparring. So anyway, he put John Thaxton. He said, Jan. So he got John Thaxton in the ring with me. And I said, go on then, let's see how you go. So we get in there. Well, John Thaxton was trying to KO me. And I was thinking, what? This is a spot. So anyway, I'm just about to pull a trigger on John. And Brendan goes, stop. So stopped. And he said, that'll do you now. Now we go with anybody now. I thought, well, what a fucking, wrong, but that's life. Don't get me wrong. God bless Brendan Ingle. What a great, as far as I'm concerned, one of the greatest trainers I've had, especially with Jimmy Tibbs, Glenn Rhodes. Sam Adair. There has been some extraordinary boxing trainers I've had. I've had some great trainers.
You trained there in Sheffield at Wincobank for a bit with Brendan then?
Yeah, I did. And I had to go to train, spar Naz nearly every day. But the thing is, Naz sort of controlled the place, he sort of controlled it, and don't get me wrong, he was world champion. The guy, as far as I'm concerned, he was one of the greatest fighters of my era, right? Whether you love him or hate him, he was one of the greatest extraordinary fighters of my era. We'd have people like Michael Jackson ringing him up. you know, you just think, wow, you know, and the guy was driving around in a Porsche, you know, convertible when outside the gym when I was there. You know, people like Will Smith would be on the phone to him. I think, oh, you know, it's nothing to him. And I thought, wow. So it's quite enterprising, you know, the way the guy was. I mean, he'd sell out. He would sell out proper stadiums and anywhere in the world. That's how big Prince Naseem was. However, you know, we sort of fell out over something. And I went down and trained with Jimmy Tibbs then and stayed in London for a bit in the Peacock Gym, which was okay. Yeah. But yeah, Naz, we used to spar every day, me and Naz. I remember we sparred, right? Before he boxed some kid in Dublin in or Ireland. He boxed some guy in Ireland, defended his world title in Ireland. I forgot the guy's name. I think he was the Mexican name. And it was in 97. And we got close. You know, I caught him in the corner. And then we got close and we banged heads. And he had a big cut on his eye. And this is 2 weeks before the fight. And I went, oh. Brendan said, stop. And just walked out the gym. And I went, God. So, but he's, it still went ahead. The fight still went ahead. I don't know what they've done with it, but I know the fight still went ahead. But as I say, I wasn't on that bill, even though I was due to be on it, but I wasn't on it. That's life, eh?
I mean, you know, Naz has gone down in the sport as a legend. You know, sometimes I speak to boxing fans now when we're young, you know, and he's just, it's like us now watching, you know, the old timers on videos to some people. But, you know, to speak to someone who sparred with Naz every day is not something. I know you said you didn't really want to speak about it, and, you know, that's up to you, mate. But, you know, to speak to someone who sparred with him every day like that, like you did, I can't help but have to pick your brains about it.
I'm not being funny, but you know when you're in that gym, you're sparring with Ryan Rhodes, you're Pele Reed, you're sparring with Herbie Hyde, you're sparring with John Keenan, you're sparring with some serious talent in that gym, right? And we're all in the ring at the same time, I think. So they're all doing a body sparring and moving around. It was a fantastic gym to be in. But then again, Glenn Rhodes was a fantastic gym to be in, you know. All the gyms are going like that, you know, so it's one of them things, isn't it? So, yeah, but, you know, when you've been in a ring with someone like ABI, yeah, it's only body spars, so you're only conditioning yourself up into the body, and Pelly Reed and people like that, but Ryan Rhodes, great fighter, what a great, superb fighter. I'm surprised he never won a world title. But then you've got, John Thaxton. I'm trying to think of all the names.
Johnny Nelson was there.
You're quite right. Johnny Nelson was there. You're sparring Johnny Nelson. You're sparring Ishan Pickering's another great fighter. But they were all, little Dave Caldwell. We used to spar with little Dave. Dave was a great little fighter. You know, it was like a family. And that's what, and no one bullied anyone. No one tried to smash anyone to pieces. We all stayed in the same boat and we all worked together, you know. So it was great. And it was quite, when you get in the ring with Ryan Rhodes and you think, and it's all body and you see the skill them kids have got, it's fantastic. You think, wow. And it sort of rubs off, you know. But we've done the same in Glynn's. So yeah.
And Glynn's is in Sheffield as well, Wincobank there. So how long was you at Wincobank for then? And Sheffield, and then Glynn's in Sheffield overall at that point? Because then you said you went back down to London.
Yeah, I had one fight for Brendan and I got put down. Well, I got put down against some Mexican, right, in Chesterfield. And I think it is because I've been doing too much body sparring. All of a sudden, I'm doing all this body sparring, not worried about my chin. And I boxed this Mexican in Chesterfield. And he does this big swing. And I'm straight down. I think, what? So gets up and obviously wins on points. I'm sort of used to open sparring. But anyway, that's part of life now. You know, can I just, before I forget, you know, Vic Andretti was another great trainer. You know, the Vic Andretti and Nigel Benn. I just trained with Nigel Benn in Miami, in, you know, Atlantic City and that. And do you know what? we all flew off to Miami. But you know, Vic Andretti was a superb trainer. I mean, I know he's died now, but what a lovely, lovely guy as well. And that was for Ambrose Mendy. Ambrose, another highly successful manager or agent, you know. But when you look at the fighters that I've been at the side of, you know, Steve Collins, I used to sometimes, we used to run every day. We used to run every single day in Northern Ireland together, me and Steve Collins, right? And every morning we'd get me up, but we'd get up and we'd go and run, you know, before we went to gym. So, and that's Steve Collins, but I used to train with Nigel Benn. And I remember one time they were due to fight each other, and it was in Manchester. I think it was the GMX in Manchester. And I'm outside waiting, and I didn't know what to do because I'm mates with both of them. So I didn't know which one to say, how you doing, you know, and as you do. But I done it quite organised, seeing Nigel come straight, all right, Rich, how you doing? I said, Nigel, fine, yeah. He was cuddling all that. And he went in, and all of a sudden, I think Steve Collins coming first, actually. Steve Collins coming first. So seeing Steve, give him a cuddle and all that, and then Nigel come in, you know, and then Nigel went from there. But they are two great fighters. And you know, they're the type of guys, you know, you walk around and you think, you know, while flying over to the States, me, Nigel Benn, and my brother, and a couple of others, Nigel Benn was in first class. And we had economy. So anyway, he was quite well known then, Nigel Benn. So we come back to see us, walked out of first class, come down the stairs, come to see us. We were near enough the front of the plane. And he said, hi, Rich. I'm saying, hello, Nigel, looking around. Hello, Nigel, he's with us, you know. All that bullshit, yeah. But what a guy, yeah, Nigel Benn. Lovely guy. But Steve Collins, an equally lovely guy, you know.
So that would have been when you're based over, like say, in Belfast and all that, when you was with Barney. So that was before Steve went over to America to train with Petrocelli's and all that and went on to win the world title. What was he like then? Am I right then in saying that? What was he like, Steve, at that point? Or what stage was he at his career when you first met him? You was training with him.
Steve had a massive name because he was from Ireland, but he went to the States and earned his respect over in the States by beating some great fighters. And but he come to Eastwood's gym, and we didn't expect it. And what a fight, what a guy, what a lovely guy, though, first and foremost. Both of them are lovely guys. And you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, they'll always be friends with me. But people don't see the niceness in some people, you know. But they are great, lovely, humbled, very humble guys, you know.
Yeah. What did you do? What was the situation in America with Nigel Benn? Where was you training there?
Well, I was in the gym at the time. Me and Nigel Benn and a few others are training. Vic Andretti. Vic Andretti got a phone call in the gym. In fact, it was the Fifth Street gym in Miami, South Beach, Miami. It was a Fifth Street gym there. Well, Vic Andretti got a phone call while we were all in the ring, shadow boxing. And he's on the phone and said, "What? Yeah, who's that?" And anyway, It was a call for someone, for Nigel to fight someone like Chris Eubank. I think it was Chris Eubank. And he said, "Oh, yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, we'll take that on." And that was when they took the fight on. I thought, okay. But I'd never heard of Chris Eubank. So, you know, at the time. So they, you know, that's it. But I don't know if that's it. Listen, don't sue me. I've got no money. So there you go. Only a bottle of red.